Thank you. greet them, but if you're all sitting by someone you don't know, it would take 10 minutes for us to all meet each other. So you're all sitting with brothers and sisters in Christ, and we're going to worship together. In our service today, we're going to be celebrating All Saints Day. It's a day when we think about the victory that Christ has given to those who preceded us into heaven. But as we think about those saints, we can't help but think about ourselves here on earth. And so we'll also be thinking about the victory that we have, even now, because of Jesus, and what that means for us as we, his saints, live here on earth. The service that we'll use this morning is printed for you in your worship folder. If you don't have one of those, the ushers have them in the back for you. Please get one from them. Hymns are printed in there for you as well. And so let's begin our service with our opening hymn. It's hymn number 880, For All the Saints, and the verses as they're listed in the worship folder.
Created us to love and serve him as his dear children. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit your people together into one holy church, the body of Christ our Lord. Grant us grace to follow the example of your blessed saints in lives of faith and willing service, and with them at last inherit the inexpressible joys that you have prepared for those who love us. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Chapter 7, verses 9 to 17. This portion of scripture will serve as the basis for our sermon today. John writes, "After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb.' All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, 'Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen.' And one of the elders asked me, 'These in white robes, who are they and where do they come from?' I answered, 'Sir, you know.' And he said, 'These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them in his presence. Never again will they hunger. Never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes.' This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God."
We'll join together to sing Psalm 27.
Oh,
Our second portion of scripture today is taken from the first epistle of John, chapter 3, verses 1 to 3. First John reminds us, God's people, of an established fact through Christ Jesus that we are the children of God, that that is our identity and who we are. That's what we know. But then he adds on that there's something, a part of us that we don't know. We don't know yet just how great that is. Now, what God has in store for us is saints. John writes, "See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God. And what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure." This is the word of the Lord. Now, Harry Andrews by the Fox Valley Union High School Choir. Thank you. gospel lesson today is taken from Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 12. Very famous portion of scripture, it's a famous part of the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus lists, you know, blessed are they. He lists reasons. And as we read through it, what's going on is if you could ask the Holy Spirit for a personality profile for the saints, here you go. This is what God's people are like, how we look at life as we go through this world until God brings to fulfillment our sainthood. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him and he began to teach them. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Grace and mercy and peace be to you, from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. First of all, unrelated to the sermon, you guys are a good part of it. Sitting up here, I can hear you well. Thank you. We're going to consider the first lesson from this morning, from Revelation chapter 7. In the name of our triune God, brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ our Lord. If you took Latin when you were in high school, one of the early things you learned in Latin was some variation of the same. Latin is a dead, dead language, as dead as it can be. First it killed the Romans, now it's killing me. This was written on, I took 4 years of Latin, this was written on the inside cover of every one of the Latin textbooks I had all 4 years. Whether it was written by me or not does not add to the point of the sermon, we're not going to deal with that. There. I had a hard time with Latin. I did not enjoy it. It was a very difficult class for me. I mean, I wasn't the greatest student, but my first 2 years of Latin were at Lassiter High School in Marietta, Georgia. The teacher was Miss Loveday. She was not very exciting. She was rumored among the student body to be the Latin teacher because it was her native language. It was hard. I just did not enjoy Latin. I don't like Latin. Okay, let's just stick with that. So now Tuesday morning comes along, this past Tuesday, October 31st, day of the Reformation. Pastor Falkenberg, Mr. Zarling, and myself are meeting as we do on Tuesday morning. And we get word that we need to come over here and look out the window by the door because there's a sign we need to read. And so we do. We come over and we read it. And if you didn't see it when you came walking in, it's in the theme of the Reformation, it's 95 reasons that we love our pastors. It's in Latin. And so I'm looking at these signs on the outside, and it's I'm happy. This is nice. It's a very nice thing the congregation has done, very encouraging, but I'm picking out key words, and by key words, I mean like Wempner and Alfenberg and Zarling. These are the key words I'm reading. I don't understand what it says at all. I'm completely confused. I'm very frustrated by this. I'm happy, confused at the same moment. I'm not sure what to make of this. Although I will note for you, not all three pastors were frustrated. If you translated that into Latin, whoever you were, and you didn't use Google Translate, Pastor Zarling has been waiting to be your best friend his entire life. He liked the Latin, but for me, oh, this was so frustrating. I was so upset that for a moment, I want you to imagine yourself reading some document that you really, really want to read, but it's in some language you can't read. Oh, how frustrating that is. And the good news is, it's English on the inside. So I do know what that is. I figured that out after a few moments. But imagine yourself reading a document in a language you don't understand and how hard that is, how frustrating that is. You really want this information, but you can't get it. Now let's take that an absolute quantum leap forward into Revelation chapter 7. The frustration that I felt, let's take that into Revelation chapter 7, where in this section of God's Word, life right here, the life you're living in this world right now, is called the Great Tribulation. That phrase is not talking about sometime off in the future when it'll get really, really bad. It's talking about right now. Actually, if you literally translate the words there from the Greek, and I do know my Greek better than I know my Latin, but the Greek says these are the ones who are coming out of the Great Tribulation. It's a present tense, an ongoing thing. It's describing life here on this earth, and it describes life here as a Great Tribulation. Latin's difficult, but life's way tougher, isn't it? And to people like you, like us, living in this Great Tribulation, Revelation chapter 7 was written to give you a glimpse of the hope that is yours, to give you a picture of the comfort and the peace that God wants to be in your heart. This section just drips with God's love for you, one for you, so that as you're living here, and it is a great tribulation, you can know what God has done. As we celebrate All Saints Day, we can't help but think of one of the most difficult parts of living in this great tribulation. The fact that there are people who aren't with us, your friends or family members or members of our congregation, who aren't here anymore. They have passed away. They're gone. It cannot be undone. It cannot be changed. And the pain that we feel from that is not just some illusion and we got it all wrong. No, it's a very real pain because someone's not here. It is a tribulation that we deal with, that these people are gone. And John in our text wants to give us a glimpse of what happened. Something to not only ease the pain for what we're feeling right now, but to help us as we think about the fact that someday I'll be the one who's missing. He gives us the comfort of telling us that those who've gone, they are before the throne of God. They see the Lamb. They are with him. The consequences of their sins are completely gone. I think we can safely say the joy that they experience is we aren't actually able to comprehend it. To comprehend the joy that those people know who have been gathered to the joy of heaven. And as I've said in many funeral sermons, but I'll say it again. Those ones you love dearly, and they dearly love you who've gone to heaven, they don't want to come back here. They don't. Because the joy that they experience is so perfect that they don't want to be here in the great tribulation anymore. They want to be there. They want you to be with them, sure. But they don't want to come back here because they experience the perfection of heaven. We in the Christian church remember our dead. We remember those who have passed ahead of us, who are already in heaven. And we do it with the confidence and the joy of knowing that Jesus Christ took those people to the glory of heaven. And we have that confidence because we know it's not based on how good they were, but it's based on what Jesus said he's done for them. It's based on the promises of his forgiveness and his love. And quite frankly, that forgiveness and that love that Christ showed to them is the forgiveness and the love that gives us a right perspective on life. Because it reminds us what God is doing for us. Our confidence is not in ourselves. You heard it in the reading about the multitude that no one could count. It says, they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Jesus saved them. Jesus took their sins away. Jesus purified them. As we live here in this great tribulation, and it is, we just get heaping portions of tribulation, don't we? Of sin and its consequences and godlessness and selfishness that the world just pours out on us in this great tribulation. But the reality is, my problem isn't really what they're doing. My problem is what I've been doing. The stuff I've been doing excludes me from the kingdom of God. You see, the church doesn't exist just to tell you, hey, go be nice. Be better people. Then you'll be better. That's what we need. I mean, it would be good if you're better people, right? There's nothing wrong with that, but being better doesn't fix us. The church doesn't exist to tell you, stop it. You're doing some absolutely stupid, simple things. Stop it. And if you'll stop doing those things, then maybe God will look and smile at you. The church exists because we are people who have not been nice. We are people who have done some horribly stupid, sinful things. And yet our God announces to us that for the sake of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. The blood of our Savior purifies us. He took those sins to the cross and he was punished for them. And he has washed us to be pure and holy in his sight. We are the ones standing before God in robes of white righteousness, covered in Christ's forgiveness. We are the ones holding the palm branches. Maybe not that. Maybe literally not that. But because of Christ, confidence of knowing that Jesus Christ has saved us. And even as we think about that most difficult part of this great tribulation, death itself, we see death through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has said that he overcame death for all his people. The ones who've already gone there, he overcame death for them. They will rise to live in the glory of heaven. He's overcome death for you too. The same fate awaits you. The inevitability of death for us is just the inevitability of heaven. It's the inevitability of life eternal with our God. This is the comfort that we have as we think about those who preceded us and as we think about ourselves. That our Lord Jesus Christ has purified us and made us to be his people who are righteous and holy, in spite of the fact that right now it's a great tribulation. And there's all kinds of problems around us. And so while this comfort of seeing this glimpse into heaven, it gives us hope for the future, doesn't it? That's what's coming. That's how your story ends. It does. It ends with you in that great multitude that no one can count because Jesus Christ has saved you. But here we are, in the great tribulation. And there's peace for us as well. The peace of knowing we're God's people. The peace of knowing his love, even with all the troubles that we see. That's what Jesus is talking about in our gospel lesson, wasn't it? About life here in the great tribulation. About what it's like. You heard him talk about it. He talked about those who are poor in spirit, or mourning, or meek, or persecuted, people to whom all kinds of evil are set against us because we're Christians. As we live here in the great tribulation, it's not easy, is it? There's all kinds of problems and sorrows, and yet, as you listen to what Jesus said, did you hear the bell toll that just keeps repeating it throughout that lesson? Blessed are you. Even as you're here in the great tribulation, blessed, he says to his people. Blessed because your sins are washed away and God considers you one of his own children. That, right, from our second lesson? That's what we really are, the children of God. God views you as his family and watches over you like parents watch over their little children. That's how God views you. Even here in the great tribulation, you are blessed because God is with you. You are blessed to be the people who, having been set free from sin, can live your lives in the way that's described there, being the merciful and the peacemakers, the pure in heart. Brothers and sisters, we are the saints of God here on earth in this great tribulation. We are the people who are blessed. Blessed to know Jesus as our Savior. We are the people who live in the peace of his forgiveness, even though it's a great tribulation. And so we are the people who can rejoice and be glad. In spite of the problems that we face, is life still frustrating? Right? Latin's just the tip of the iceberg, right? There's all sorts of frustrations. Are we sad? Yes, sometimes we genuinely are sad. There are problems and hardships in life. And yet we can rejoice and be glad because we are blessed to be the people of God. We know and can say, as we heard in our text, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. He poured out that salvation on the lives of those who preceded us to heaven. He's poured it out on you, sitting here in these pews, hoping that this sermon won't be that long. That's number 75 on the list. Our sermons aren't that long. As you sit in this great tribulation of life, you sit with the peace and the confidence of knowing that your Savior has purified you and made you to be his people. You can rejoice and be glad in the peace that comes from this glimpse into heaven. You can rejoice and be glad with the confidence of knowing that's for you. It will come. And you can even rejoice and be glad right now as you're living in the trouble, great tribulation, with the peace of knowing your God is with you. He will not leave you. He will bless you. Bless. Blessed, he says. to you. Amen. The peace of God that passes all understanding will guard and keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Please rise. We'll join in the confession of faith, the Apostles' Creed, on page 12. I believe in God, the Father Almighty. We lift our eyes to you whose throne is in heaven, and your great love has led us to bring you these gifts. May they be used for the good of your kingdom and the proclamation of your great name. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our prayers this morning will include a prayer for our brother in the faith, Gerald Meyer, grandfather of our member, Ben Bush, whom the Lord called home to heaven this past week. We'll also include a prayer for our brother, Roger Jarks. Roger broke his hip this past week, and he will be undergoing surgery in the coming days. With thanksgiving and praise, O Lord, we remember all your faithful servants who throughout the ages have witnessed to your name. The mighty and the lowly, great leaders and humble men and women, those who have served you in prosperity and in times of trouble. We rejoice that they now rest from their labors in your presence. Heavenly Father, we recall with thanksgiving what you have done for your church through them. May their good deeds, prompted by your love in Christ and performed in your glory, while here on earth, encourage us to live for you. As we join our worship and work with theirs, may we acknowledge ourselves to be part of that great cloud of witnesses from every age and place. Unite all your people in the true faith, in the hope of an eternity at your side, and in the love that reveals us to be your children. And Heavenly Father, we ask you to be with our brother Roger. As he undergoes surgery in the coming days, please guide the hands of the surgeons. Please grant him confidence and comfort in your promises. And Lord God, Lord of life and death, we thank you for all the mercies with which you blessed our fellow believer Gerald, now fallen asleep. We thank you especially for having brought him to the knowledge of your Son, Jesus. We pray that you would comfort his family and all who mourn his death with your precious promises, and share them with the sure hope of a blessed reunion in heaven. Holy Spirit, our comfort in trouble and guide through this life. As you have protected and prospered your saints in the past, look with favor on us now and bring us safely to eternal glory. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And we join the prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please be seated for our next hymn.
before you begin, a couple announcements this morning. First off, thank you very much to both choirs, from Illinois Lutheran High School of Fox Valley, for coming and beautifying our worship this morning. Very, very good singing. And along with that, for the students, the choir members, and their families, there is a potluck after the service. It's down the hall, up that little ramp, and to your right. And then a couple things on the schedule. First off, there is a blood drive coming up. Please note that. Also, if you remember, we had called Miss Katie Yeager to teach at the Inglewood School next year. She did return that call. So next Sunday, we're going to have another call meeting after the late service. So please note that for next Sunday. And then finally, just to bring this train into the station, I love that. I was tickled pink when I saw that list was in that. But in any case, thank you everyone. All three pastors really made our day, made our week, in fact. It was just very, very cool. So with that, may God richly bless your week.
Thank you. Come on.